to me all ye that labor.
Special day. We just memorialized our friends and loved ones. And now we'll enter into a time of celebration, celebrating 98 years of service, 98 years of family, 98 years of building believers, and 98 years of sharing Christ, 98 years of caring for all, 98 years of sacrifice, 98 years of ministry, and 98 years on bended knee. 98 years of walking alongside one another through life's most challenging and rewarding times. Welcome to the Second Baptist Church of Santa Ana 98th anniversary.
Put your hands together. Thank you.
1 John 5:14 says, "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us." Teddy, you want to pray?
Bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Lord, I hope that when I'm not treating my stuffed animals badly, that dear Lord, I will treat them goodly, and I hope I do my chores, dusting very well. And Lord God, you do all great things. And I know we can't be like you, but the Lord God, I know what you can do. You can help us and lead us to the tough things. And I know in the Bible that I know some people have died, but they tried all they can, Lord God. I hope you to be good in Pastor Pitt's family. I hope for the pastor. I hope that we will all get good cover, Lord. This house and your God is Holy Mountain. Your God, you are so good, and you make the mountains so high and the skies above. Lord God, you made the clouds flow in the sky, and you made the ground underneath, the goats to only grass, but not wheat. Lord God, you made everything different, and what you made different is true. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for 98 beautiful years of Second Baptist Church, God. I just want to thank you for all the past leaders that has brought us to where we are today, God, and was able to fight through oppression and everything that was going on, God. I want to thank you for the current leaders we have right now, God. I want to pray for Pastor Pitts. I want to pray that you keep your hand over him and give him the vision to keep leading this next generation, God. I want to pray and thank for I want to thank you for the staff, the deacons, and everybody that assists your church, God. Please, and also, God, I really want to pray for my generation. Just keep giving us the vision and just keep helping us get to you, and always keep your voice in our head. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Hello, family. As we celebrate our anniversary today, it, for me, is a time of reflection. I constantly want to think about how did we start and how do we finish well? We started as a church that brought people together so they can find family, find worship, find a community of believers where they can express the love of God to every nation, generation, and situation. As we prepare our hearts and minds for giving, I want you to think about that for a moment. This church, for 98 years, has been a beacon of hope in this community. We've made a difference with homelessness, and we've made a difference with hungriness. We've made a difference with homework and helping the elder and the young as well. And we want to take it to another level. We really want to be a church that is sharing the love of God, and that this community would hurt if we weren't here. And so we want to start today a scholarship fund. In 2 years, we would like to bring two students from I Can Fly International, two young ladies from that orphanage, to be educated here in college, that they can get a good education and go back to Kenya to make a difference. And we want to do this year after year after year for the next 10 years, starting 2 years from now. And we believe that when we help educate a community, those young people will go back and change that community. We want to be a part of the change that we desire to see. We believe change happens one good deed at a time. I invite you to continue to be generous to this church, to this ministry, as we are generous to this world. Let us think, let us pause, and let us pray. God, we thank you for 98 years of celebration, 98 years of worship, 98 years of discipleship, 98 years of fellowship, and 98 years of generous stewardship. Thank you for all the years that you have blessed us to be here, and thank you for all the people who have given over the years. Now, God, I pray that even though we have been the recipients of incredible blessings, that you encourage us to do even more, because you are a more giving God. God, thank you for giving a giver something to give. And I pray, oh God, that we will continue to press toward the mark of the higher calling. Thank you, O God, for being who you are, and thank you for using us and allowing us to partner with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There are several ways to give during this season of online-only services. Visit sbc.family and click Give in the top right-hand corner. You can also text to give. Just text the amount to 833-918-0019 and then follow the directions when prompted. Make your giving go further by using your bank account instead of your debit or credit card to avoid additional fees for SBC. But if you want to use your card, please consider covering the 3% service charge the church will incur. Of course, you can always mail in your offering by sending a check to Second Baptist Church, 4300 Westminster Avenue, Santa Ana, California, 92703. Because of your generous support, SBC has continued to move forward, steadfast in our mission to share Christ, build believers, and care for all.
We're about to do something we haven't done in a while. Here at Second Baptist Church, we have a special way of loving on one another. We call it the love break.
Hello, Second Baptist. Do you know what today is? It's our anniversary. Happy anniversary, Second Baptist Church. Love ya.
Happy anniversary, SBC, from the Oyenusi family. We are taking this time to thank God again for our founding mother, for her obedience in starting the fellowship that grew into a church, and for her humility in handing over due to the growth. And the church is still growing. Happy anniversary.
Second Baptist Church, did you know we are getting ready to celebrate 100 years? I am so glad to be a part of this journey. You know, we're ending 100, but we're stepping into the next 100. Praise God for his many blessings, and I'll see you soon. God bless.
Hello, SBC. This is the Wednesday night small group Bible study in Fountain Valley. I'm Doris Gordon, and I'm here with Cynthia Fountain, Jeanette Evans, Thomas Fisher, Paula Fisher, Charles McCall, and Carolyn Hunt. And we just want to say we love you and we miss you.
We miss you, SBC.
Hey, church family, it's Latricia Thomas. Just wanting to say hello. Hope you all are being safe and taking care of yourselves. And also wanting to wish you all a happy church anniversary. Have a great day.
As I travel through life's ups and downs, I never have to fear, 'cause the one who loves me, keeps me and leads me, whispers in my ear. He has all the answers for anyone who calls upon his name. He's Alpha and Omega, the great I am, every day the same. He's my master.
That's what I call.
My
provider.
That's what I call him.
My
Anniversary, Second Baptist, and all of our friends and family, thank you for joining us today as we celebrate 98 years of worship, of praise, and of service. We are so excited because we have with us today, all the way from Chicago, a product of Morehouse College, Reverend Stephen Thurston, who is a phenomenal preacher, an incredible teacher, a facilitator, an entrepreneur, but most of all, a friend of SBC. Ladies and gentlemen, buckle your seatbelt and enjoy the word.
Pastor Pitts, Second Baptist Church, thank you for the opportunity to share with you to celebrate 98 years of doing work, doing ministry, not only among the congregation, but in the community there in Orange County. I celebrate you, and I'm honored that I was selected to share with you today. People often invite you back for one of two reasons. Number one, they thoroughly enjoyed you the last time you were there and they wanted to come and hear you again. Or number two, you didn't do so hot and they wanted to give you another opportunity to get it right. So for whatever reason you've invited me to come back for a second occasion, I thank you. I appreciate it. So many voices from across the nation, Pastor Pitts, that you could have invited, and I really do appreciate our friendship and you inviting me to share. Well, listen, I don't want to hold you all day long, so let's jump into our assignment today. If you've come equipped with your own personal copy of the Kingdom's Constitution, that's the Bible for those of y'all looking at the screen, real funny right there. Join me in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 8, verses 36 to 38. The NIV is the version I'll be reading from today, and it reads like this. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What can stand in the way of me being baptized?" And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. For our time of sharing today, I want to hang this headline above the text. Headline reading, The Gospel of Inclusion. The Gospel of Inclusion. In environments ranging from entertainment to education, diversity and inclusion have become more than just buzzwords or boxes to check off. They're essential to any organization's success. In corporate America, not only are common mission, vision, and purpose across all levels of the organization essential, but so are the celebration, the validation, and the veneration of each individual and the unique attributes that they bring to the table. If growth and achievement are the expected outcome, then diversity and inclusion are imperative inputs. From affirmative action policies to the Executive Order 9981, abolishing discrimination on the basis of race, color, religion, or national origin in the armed forces, to Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, prohibiting employment discrimination based on sex, race, color, religion, or national origin, conversation and considerations concerning diversity and inclusion have been enmeshed within our national narrative. While the two terms have been coupled together and used interchangeably for the past 40 years, it's important to note that diversity and inclusion are two different things. They are not the same. Whereas diversity represents the full spectrum of human demographic differences, inclusion refers to the feeling of belonging, the extent to which people are valued, respected, accepted, and encouraged to fully participate. I see y'all looking at me funny on the other side of the screen, so let me lay the hay where the horses can get to it because somebody missed it. I'm simply seeking to suggest that diversity is being invited to the party and inclusion is being asked to dance. While the intentionality of diversity and inclusion have proved profitable in the marketplace, when we take an honest examination of the ministry space, homogeneity and exclusion have appeared to become our normal and our standard. I know that we see ourselves as a welcoming and an inviting source, a community, a collective community of people that embrace and that loves everybody, and a good number of us are. I know that we frame the church as a place of restoration, a place where the broken are made whole, a place where healing waters flow and mercy abides, and many churches are. But as long as church people continue to maintain this us versus them mindset, our implicit discrimination will continue to cause us to reject and exclude others as we secure our seats on the inside. Can we be honest today? For many, it's just a facade of welcome. It's a screen of acceptance that hides a toxic environment filled with polluted perspectives. It's extremely telling when a person falls short in the ministry space, how church people will give them hell before they'll give them hell. Y'all not gonna talk with me today. Now, I thought that the Bible said, and they'll know that we're Christians by our love, not, and they'll know we're Christians by who we show our love to. We've gotta be honest about our explicit and implicit biases and prejudices and expose the hidden hazards in our hearts that hinder us from being authentically and radically welcoming and inclusive. In Matthew chapter 28, Jesus gives what's known as the Great Commission. In Acts chapter 1, verse number 8, he broadens the boundaries of his reach and the reach of the gospel and confirms that it's an inclusive gospel. It has an inclusive nature. Jesus makes it clear that salvation is for everyone. Thus, the church should be a hub for healing rather than a holy huddle for members only. The church, it's a collective community, and community is important. But community can turn to calamity when the boundary lines around a community are opaque, solid, and engineered to exclude. Jesus dined with sinners. If I've got some Bible readers here, you'll testify here. He dined with sinners. He touched lepers. As a Jew, he openly engaged Samaritans. He connected with those that society had decided to reject. He rebelled against prejudice and discrimination. Yet the church is filled with Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized, blood bought and blood washed, saved, sanctified, redeemed believers, purposefully practicing exclusion in Jesus' name. And I get it. Sometimes we get on the inside and we forget what it's like to be on the outside. Outside looking in, wanting to get in, but can't get in. Well, Stephen, how is it that I can make this shift? How can we move from practicing exclusion to representing a gospel of inclusion? That's a great question. And I'm so glad you asked, especially since you're in a place as a ministry of sharing Christ, building believers, and caring for all. How is it that we can make the shift from being so internally focused to having an external focus? It's a great question. I'm glad you're asking amazing questions today, because I believe that the text before us today is tailored to teach us how to make this shift. As we penetrate the periphery of this particular pericope, we encounter a deacon and a deformity. As we tune into the times of our text, Jesus has recently resurrected from the grave, and as the gospel is being spread, Christ's followers are facing dread due to attack and persecution. As things heat up in Jerusalem, Philip makes his way to Samaria to run a revival. But in the midst of ministry, this deacon is divinely diverted and directed to a remote desert place where he meets a deformity. The text tells us that this gender-bending foreigner from a racial minority has traveled some 1,500 miles from present-day Sudan to Jerusalem to worship in the temple, only to be excluded because of his queered body. Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 1, and Leviticus chapter 21, verse 16 through 20, informs us that eunuchs were sexual outcasts in Jewish religious society. I'm in the text. And so in spite of his profile, and he had one, because this man had power, he had position and prosperity, none of that precluded them from the problem. And you're asking, what's the problem that precluded him, Stephen? The problem of prejudice. Because when they see us, they always find a problem with us. Oh, come on, Second Baptist. Y'all can talk with me right here. It's Black History Month. As the oldest African-American religious community in Orange County, you know what I'm talking about when I say when they see us, they always find a problem with us. Here in the text, this Ethiopian eunuch, this black man, is now on his way home from church, a church that rejected him, a church that refused him, a church that declined him, a church that shunned him, a church that excluded him. And it's at this point in his life that Philip enters into his story. In the midst of his rejection, the text tells us in verse 26 that now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out. And on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandake, which means queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah, the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Isn't it amazing how when you're yielded and a yielded vessel to God, and sensitive to the leading of the Spirit, how God will place you right where you need to be when you need to be there. Oh, here in the text, the first thing that I see here in the text is that Philip was commissioned to connect. We often find ourselves labeling our encounters with individuals as accidental encounters. But the reality of the matter is that they're often really just holy hookups. Yeah, God sent you there on purpose, with a purpose, for a purpose. It wasn't by accident that your path crossed with that individual. It wasn't by happenstance that you sat next to that particular individual on that flight when other seats were open. It wasn't bad timing that you got caught at that red light, and now the person who's been cast away by society is standing at your window seeking to engage you. They sat next to you on the train on purpose. They sat next to you on the bus on purpose. They were standing next to you in line on purpose. You got moved to that particular shift on your work, at your job experience, to engage that group of people on purpose. And the question that you're asking is why? Why did I sit next to them? Why did I stand next to them? Why did I encounter them? Why did I pass cross? Why am I now working with them? Because they couldn't get in the church to hear the gospel. So God decided to send the church to them and has commissioned you to connect with them so that the gospel can be inclusively shared with those who might feel excluded by the church. Oh, y'all want to act like you don't know that the church can be exclusive. Oh, it can, because the church says they don't fit. Oh, they're mentally unstable. We're not accessible for people with different abilities. We smell liquor on their breath. We smell loud. We smell the weed reeking from their clothing. We see the track marks on their arm. Oh, no, his criminal record is too extensive. They don't have on the right clothes. They don't live in the right zip code. They don't speak our language. They don't have the right ethnic background to be a part of our community. She's a stripper. Their personal hygiene isn't up to standards. They're from the wrong side of the tracks. They've got too many tattoos and too many piercings in too many places. Last year, he was Bruce, but this year, he wants to be known as Caitlin. Y'all shut down on me. They're on the autism spectrum, and we don't know how to deal with that. They've got theological questions and perspectives that we're not ready to wrestle with. So since the church keeps finding reasons and excuses to engage in exclusion, God says, Philip, I'm going to connect you and commission you to connect, to represent me and show that the gospel is all about inclusion. What I love about this Ethiopian eunuch narrative is that while his stuff kept him from getting to God, it didn't stop God from getting to him. Here's my word of encouragement. Stop allowing these sanctimonious, self-righteous, spurious saints to convince you that you're not good enough for the grace of God. Somebody tuned into this stream today. Somebody happened to run across this service today just for me to remind you of that point, that the same grace that everybody else wants extended to them is the same grace that ought to be extended to you, that God's love cares for you. God's love doesn't label you like people have, that God's love and God's grace and God's gospel is inclusive for everybody. In case you've never been told, let me be the one to announce to you today that God's grace is sufficient for you. His forgiveness for sin, it's available to all who have faith simply to believe in him. The song goes something like this. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. How it chases me down, fights till I'm found. Leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. That reckless love of God, it's chasing after you. If the gospel is going to be reintroduced as inclusive, not only will we be commissioned to connect, but second, we'll be commissioned to converse. I'm still in the text. It's right here in verse number 30. The text says, then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you're reading? Philip asked. How can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me. So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. This is the passage of scripture the eunuch was reading. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent. So he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of this, of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. Here in the text, this scene is what I find interesting, Pastor Pitts. It's very intriguing to me. As Luke glosses over the deep social and cultural implications of this particular engagement in the text. But here it is. We have a gender-bending foreigner from a racial minority inviting a Jewish man who represents all that rejects and excludes him spiritually and socially to join him in his chariot for conversation and Bible study. Y'all missed it. Let me back that thing up and get it for you. For those of you riding the slow bus, I'm gonna take it real slow. Here we find in the text an oxymoronic experience and encounter and engagement. Here we have a gender-bending foreigner from a racial minority inviting a Jewish man to come and sit in his car and have a conversation with him and a Bible study. This Jewish man who he invites to sit in his car is one who represents all that rejects him and excludes him socially, spiritually, and culturally. Yet they're able to come together to have a conversation. This is important for a plethora of reasons, but for the sake of our subject today, it's imperative for us to grasp Philip's sensitivity to the fact that he could not lead this eunuch until he first listened to this eunuch. Somebody missed it. He couldn't lead him until he first listened to him. Graceful in his engagement, Philip enters now this stranger's space. And let me parenthetically pause here to remind us that in this thing called evangelism, we need to be open to meeting people on their turf. Philip receives his hospitality. He communes with him. He asks questions of him. He dialogues with him. He reaches across the divides that ought to separate the two of them. It's moments like this when individuals who differ denominationally, economically, theologically, politically, sexually, and racially are able to exchange and interact with kindness and compassion that ultimately makes a difference. These types of encounters change lives, and change lives change the world. Being inclusive with the gospel means opening ourselves up to transforming encounters with people that are different than us. While this eunuch learned something from Philip, I'm willing to wager that Philip learned something from the eunuch as well. It was an equal change. It was a two-way street. Yes, it can be profoundly challenging. It can be difficult. It can be downright scary to engage with others that are outside of our comfort zone. But if that means that one less soul spends eternity in hell, here's the question, ain't it worth it? But this means that we have to stop approaching evangelism with the scripture stick, beating people until they conform to what we're comfortable with. We keep telling people that they need to change to be able to fit into the gospel context. We keep telling people that they need to change before they can be invited in, that they need to change to be included in. But the last time I checked, neither you nor I were the makers of Christ's guest list. Inclusivity, it doesn't mean welcoming others in to become just like you, assimilate to your culture and your customs and your fit. Rather, it means welcoming them in, giving them the space to think and to ask questions, to engage and to impact the way things are actually being done. Instead of putting so much focus on what others need to do, what others need to change, how others need to conform to get in, how about we have a mirror moment and examine what walls, what barriers, what rules that we need to remove to become radically welcoming and inclusive as we extend the tent of God's grace to cover all. I'm out of your hair. I'm out of your way. I'm going to let you get back so you can Netflix and chill for the balance of the day. But Philip was commissioned to connect. Philip was commissioned to converse. Third and finally, I'm leaving you now when I tell you that Philip was commissioned to confirm. It's right here in the text. Their conversation about Christ leads to a conversion. To follow Christ. Here it is in the text. It says in verse 36, as they traveled along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, look, here is water. What can stand in the way of my being baptized? And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. Philip takes this text, which was speaking what the eunuch was feeling, and is able now to use it to share the gospel in response. The eunuch desires to engage in an outward demonstration resulting from an inward transformation. I lost you. Let me help you unpack what I just said to you. That was just a fancy way of saying that this eunuch now decides, after Philip breaks down the text, that he wants to be baptized. Implicit and explicit racism and sexism have kept him out of the church. And now this eunuch, this black man, this queered, gendered man, he's now wondering what's going to creep up now to keep him out of the water. He's experienced racism. He's experienced sexism. He was kept out of the church. And now he wants to know what systemic barrier has been set up that's going to keep him out of this water. What's going to prevent him now that he's decided to follow Jesus from full inclusion into the kingdom of God? Because Philip understood that the gospel is inclusive. Because Philip understood that neither this man's race, nor his color, nor his economic status, nor his immigration status, nor his political views, sexual orientation, or identification should serve as barriers to entrance into the kingdom of God. He confirms that this man is good enough just as he is, that nothing should separate him from the love of God. The text goes on to tell us that these two men come together and they both go down into the water together. All that mattered was that this eunuch had a desire to follow Christ. And likewise, that's all that should matter to us when we encounter people on the other side of the Christian community. A diverse and inclusive church doesn't tolerate favoritism or segregation. An inclusive church makes concrete moves to recognize and to treat and to involve every individual that we encounter with both dignity and respect. Welcoming all simply means welcoming all. And why do we do it? We do it for no other reason than the fact that God accepted us just as we are and decided that he would walk in relationship with us. And likewise, that same grace that's been extended to you and extended to me is the same grace that we've got to extend to others on the other side. There's no more us versus them. It's all of us in this together. We are our brothers and our sisters' keeper. We are salt and light. We ought to be positioning and posturing ourselves to make the gospel inclusive for any man, any woman, any boy, any girl that decides that they want to make Jesus the center of their life. It's my prayer that you would engage in the gospel of inclusion and be a welcoming ear, a welcoming eye, a welcoming shoulder, a welcoming arm, a welcoming body that invites individuals into the kingdom of God. That's my time, Second Baptist. Thank you for your time. Have an amazing day.
We learned today that prejudice has no place in the church. Jesus showed us that with his ministry when he reached out to those that the church had deemed not worthy of ministering to. When he talked to the barkeepers, when he talked to people of other races that the church had said we will not associate with, those were the folks that he let the church know, this is what my ministry is all about. This is what the Christian ministry is all about. It doesn't matter what people have done in the past. It doesn't matter how wrong they were. Everyone has an opportunity to get to know him as Lord and Savior. And so I urge you today, if you want to know Jesus as Lord and Savior, hit that connect button and just write in your comments that I want to know Jesus or I want to accept him into my life. Or you may be someone who just needs some information or you want to know a little more about Second Baptist or want to get involved maybe in some activities, do the same. Hit the connect button because we believe when we create a place for you to belong, then it helps to foster even more your relationship with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And finally, you may want to make Second Baptist your home. And if that's the case, follow that same process. Hit the connect button and then just say, I would like to become a member of Second Baptist Church. We love you and we thank you for watching today. God bless you.
Even during this unique season, SBC has welcomed several new members, and we would be thrilled to have you become a member as well and unite with us as we share Christ, build believers, and care for all. There are two ways to become a member at SBC. You can visit our website at sbc.family and select Connect in the top right-hand corner. Enter your information and indicate I want to join in the message box. If you prefer to receive a call, you can add your phone number. Or you can call the church office and leave your information on our voicemail. Once you've completed these steps, congratulations! Our virtual ministry team will welcome you into the SBC family.
Wow, what an incredible service. And we are honored to share that with you. And we are glad that you chose to be with us. I am deeply moved by the memorial, by the word, by the praise, by the worship, and by the fact that we know we've come this far by faith. When we started the pandemic some 11 months ago, can you believe it? It's been 11 months. We started a prayer call at 6:15 a.m. and 6:15 p.m. Monday through Friday. We invite you to be a part of that. We believe that prayer works and prayer changes things. So we invite you to be a part of our prayer calls every day, Monday through Friday, 6:15 a.m. and 6:15 p.m. Join us. And now for our benediction. Let us pray. May the Lord continue to bless us and keep us. May God's beautiful face shine upon us, and that face grant us peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding, that peace that confuses the enemy, the peace that keeps us in our time of need. May that peace rest, rule, and abide now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Let all God's children say, amen, amen, and amen.